Adopt Connect, and she will introduce, or he will introduce our speaker, Lori Ross.
It's really a pleasure for me to introduce Lori Ross to you. She's a remarkable woman who has been a foster and adoptive parent for 35 years, has fostered over 400 children, and adopted some 23, besides having a 5 of her own. And I tell you, it's a remarkable thing that she's done. She helped organize this Foster and Adopt Connect 20 years ago with no employees. We now have a budget of $3.5 million annually and 130 employees, and Lori is continually thinking of new ways to place difficult to adopt children. So without further ado, here's Lori Ross.
For about 2 seconds, and then I'm going to turn it over to these beautiful ladies right here. On your table, you have a brochure that gives you lots of information about Foster Adopt Connect. Foster Adopt Connect is an organization that we started as a group of foster and adoptive families almost 20 years ago. It was a small support group, and basically that group of folks have a lot of good ideas about a way to make life better for kids who ended up in foster care because they had been abused or neglected in their birth homes. There are thousands of children in the Kansas City metro area and throughout the states of Missouri and Kansas that are living out of their homes, in foster homes, in residential treatment facilities, with relative families in the Kansas City area because their parents are unable to care for them. A lot of the issues that parents are dealing with have to do with, honestly, substance abuse, a significant amount, and the economic recession did not help any. There was about a 60% increase in the number of children in care in the years since 2008, and those numbers are still pretty high, the highest they've ever been in the history of foster care, and are only just now starting to stable out in the Kansas City region. Hopefully, we're doing some good things to bring those down. But those kids come into care, and our goal, our first goal, is to get those kids back home to their birth families if they can remedy the situation that brought the kids in care. If we can't do that, then our goal is to get them connected to permanent families. When we thought about coming to talk to your Rotary Club, we wanted to talk about an issue that faces kids in the Kansas City metro area that's pretty significant, and one of our creative solutions. One of the things about us that makes us different from other organizations is that we approach this problem from the perspective of the family. I think all of you will agree with me that kids heal, thrive, become who they are in the context of their family. And so we believe that the family is the core source of support around which you do something to make things better for kids who've had abuse or neglect in their lives. Everybody else who's involved in that child's life, all the well-meaning folks in the world, cannot necessarily make things better for that child if their home situation isn't one of love and nurture, commitment and concern. So we work really hard to support lots of different ways of getting kids what they need in families. We don't believe kids should grow up in institutions. We don't believe that kids should age out of foster care and try to survive on their own at 18 years of age. So I'm going to introduce Liz and Jennifer. That's Liz, that's Jennifer. These beautiful ladies work for me, and they work in an amazing program that we call Extreme Recruitment. So there's going to be some videos behind us and up on that screen over there, and they're going to talk you through a little bit of the program. I'm going to hang around, and at the end, we'll all be available to answer questions.
Problem of children aging out of foster care. by and large, it's about 50% of children who go into foster care reunited with their families, and the other 50%, we do our best to try to get them permanency through adoption. Unfortunately, that doesn't always happen, and children age out. You will see behind me some statistics about what things look like for our kiddos that are aging out of care. If you look back to what life looked like whenever you were 18 years old, you probably thought that you knew what you were doing, that you were ready to be an adult, but you also probably remember you weren't ready and you still needed to call mom or dad or grandma or grandpa, ask them questions, get resources through these family members or, you know, family friends. Unfortunately, a lot of our kiddos don't have that benefit. As you can see, we see a lot of homelessness. We see a lot of our kiddos aging out of foster care and entering the criminal justice system. See a lot of teen pregnancy. These are all bad for our kids and just perpetuate the same issues that we tried to save them from when we took them out of their biological home in the first place. And just to put it in perspective, I have another slide. It's a lot of the same stuff, but if you look below the initial statistic, it'll show you how that compares to our other kiddos who are not in foster care. So, for example, 42% will be convicted of a crime. That's 7 times more likely than the general population. So these kiddos are leaving one institution system and they're just entering another one. And by and large, we see that that's because they don't have the support of a family. So extreme recruitment comes in when the children have been in care for at least 18 months. A lot of them have been in care a lot longer. I've worked with teenagers who have been in care for 14 years, where they haven't been able to reunify with parents, but they haven't found an adoptive resource. As Dr. Ashcraft was sharing earlier, we work with children who are more difficult to get adopted. They're older, they're part of a large sibling group, they have developmental delays or significant behaviors. We don't get the kiddos until everybody else is already out of ideas. And so, in order to find them adoptive resources or permanency, we have to always go back to our program philosophies. You can see some of them behind me. Foster care is a temporary situation. Children should not stay in foster care if they can't be reunified with their parents, which of course we support. They need to find an adoptive resource. Every child is adoptable. Children do not need to be in a stable environment in order to be with their family. That's a barrier that we come up against a lot. The professionals that we work with in child welfare, I know that they're all there and trying to do what's in the best interest of the child. What makes our program a little bit different, one of many things, is that we don't believe we need to wait for the child to be problem-free, behavior-free before they have a family. So the child might be in residential, or they might be in, you know, an upper-level career foster home, but we don't believe that that should stop us from moving forward and getting them permanency with an adoptive resource. Another thing that makes a difference is everyone in the child's family can offer assistance to what we're trying to do in finding them an adoptive resource. So one of the primary ways we find adoptive resources is within the child's own family. Previous to extreme recruitment kind of coming into child welfare, a lot of adoptive resources either came from the current foster placement, which of course is amazing, we love, or general recruitment, which is also really amazing. Those are like those websites that you see, or when children are on the news looking for an adoptive resource. Those are amazing, but the thing is, they're reactive, not proactive. You're putting the child out there and you're waiting for someone to come and say, you know, I want to adopt this child. We're going and we're finding relatives and we're knocking on doors and we're going to old teachers or old neighbors and saying, I know you have a relationship with this child. Are you interested in maybe taking that to the next level, maybe being a natural support? And sometimes those natural supports turn into a permanent placement. So those are just a few of our philosophies. And when we have an issue and we think, I don't know how to solve this, we always try to come back to some of these cornerstones. We've included our top 10 list of things that make our program different from other recruitment means. You might have heard of you know, Wednesday's Child and other programs like that that are absolutely amazing, and we work along with them. Two heads are better than one sort of situation. But there are some things that we always do different. One of them is no linear thinking. We have four different types of recruitment that we utilize. We do the general recruitment, so that's those websites. We do family finding. We will look through all of the old case records, talk to all the relatives, and try to build up what we call the genogram, the family tree, and you'll see a slide of that here in just a minute. And then we also go to those family friends, those teachers, relatives, and then lastly, targeted recruitment. That would be looking at something about the child that they like or something that makes them special and trying to zero in on an adoptive resource that way. And we'll have an example of that when we look at Connor's story here in just a second. Yeah, we're behind the desk. We're not behind the desk. At least 50% of the time we're out in the field. We're working with our investigator, Tom Pruden. He's been a detective for 20 years with the Kansas City Police Department. We work with him and go knock on doors, we call people, we go ask neighbors if they know our relatives have moved. Like, we really like to get out there on the street. Don't take no for an answer. A lot of our teenagers say they don't want to be adopted. And for a long time, their professionals that work with them will just take that as an answer because and it comes from a good place. They want to respect the child's wishes. But one, we need to know why they say no. So we need to unpack that a little bit. Two, some of these kids are like 14, 15 years old, so they're possibly making a huge life decision. We don't let 14 or 15 year olds decide when it's time to get married. So we need to kind of talk through with them, you know, why do we want to be adopted? And a lot of times it's because they don't want to be adopted by a stranger, but they would love to be adopted by a relative that they remember from their past. Number of strangers that we can recruit is finite. Relatives, we can amass hundreds and hundreds. This says 300. One of my extreme recruiters down in Springfield recently finished a genogram with over 500 named relatives. That's first, last names, and an overwhelming majority she was able to come into contact with. And you might think, isn't that a little bit overkill? Why would you even need that many relatives? Well, until she hit the 500 mark, we hadn't found an adoptive resource. After the 500 mark, she came in contact with a cousin, a very distant cousin, who was already interested in adoption, and now has started the process of adopting the child that we're working with. So the more, the wider the net, the more likely you're gonna find an adoptive resource. This is an example of the genogram. So when I took Richard's case, the case manager, all the people who had been involved for 3 years, could only tell me these relatives. Those are the only people they knew. So we went through the case files, we met with parents, and just kept building. And this is the genogram we ended with. It's about 170 relatives. Unfortunately, I couldn't pick the one that was over 500 because it would not fit on the slide. You would not be able to tell that it was a genogram. And you might notice there are some symbols. This is also a good way to get medical history, to get social history. Adoptive parents are really, you know, putting themselves out there when they say they want to adopt a child. And the more they know about the child and the child's family, the more successful we find that placement is probably going to be. Biological family is more likely to adopt, and the permanency is more likely to be sustained when their relatives or when they already know the child. There's already that investment piece. A lot of relatives we contact will tell us, I want to bring this child back into our family. I want to take care of this child who I already know. Yes, I know they have behaviors. Yes, I know they've been through a lot with their family. We just have a lot of good luck with them sticking that through. Weekly meetings are necessary. A lot happens week to week. We're moving at a really fast pace, so we try to get all the team members invested in meeting with us weekly, and that's why we can maintain ourselves as a 12 to 20 week program. Consensus drive. We don't wait for everybody to say yes to something, we just need a majority vote. If you imagine you've got 10 different people around the table with 10 different opinions, and we're trying to work fast to permanency. We can't wait for everybody to say yes. When we hear everybody out, we take everything into consideration, and then the entire team just kind of comes to a consensus. paying attention to educational issues, but go a step further. We try to make sure that we take everything off of the case manager, the lawyer, the placement resource. We try to take everything we can off of their plate because they've got enough to worry about and just getting ready for that to be a successful transition. So we try to get them set up for school, try to get them set up with a new doctor, make sure if they need therapy or help in the home that that's already set up, because these relatives and these family friends and whatnot, they didn't come to us and say, I'm ready to adopt. We came to them and said, hey, this child wants to reconnect with you. Are you interested in adoption? So we try to take stress off of them. Building trust in the family. This is where it is so important that my recruiters be the type of people who can really sit down with anyone. They do sit down and speak with judges and lawyers and other professionals in our field, but they also have to be really comfortable going anywhere, going to, you know, urban, inner city core. They need to be comfortable going to visit our relatives in trailer parks and being surrounded by dogs or whatever the case may be. They need to go in, be comfortable, make the family feel comfortable. Not just about permanency, about identity. By and large, we have a great success with finding permanency for kids. Sometimes those children are not ready to be adopted just yet, or they feel like they're ready for independent living, and whether I agree or not is irrelevant because they might go for that, but we're still able to reconnect them with relatives and let them reconnect with their own identity. A lot of the kiddos we work with, once we build a relationship with them, we really get to talking, they share with us, but they do feel like something's missing. They feel like they are losing touch with what they remember of their past and information about their families. So even if it doesn't lead to permanency, we try to build that back into the child's identity as best as we can. In our program, we only have two goals. We try to find a permanency resource and we try to reconnect them with relatives and kin. We have done that in 100% of our cases that we closed this year, and by and large, we do that 90% of the time, which is about 50% higher than any other relative program. And this is Connor. I was kind of telling you guys about targeted recruitment, so going out and finding resources and taking into consideration what the child's already into. Connor had been in foster care for a really long time. His family, we tried, they weren't appropriate, unfortunately. So we met with him and we got to know what does he care about. He really cared about JROTC, planned on enlisting someday. He really cared about staying at his high school where he had a lot of friends, he had teachers that he loved. And so our recruiter went out and went to every single church in his town to try to recruit for him. And out of all those churches, one family called her and said they were interested in learning more about Connor. That was all we needed, met with them, got started, and it just so happened that this family and Connor were an amazing connection. They had a few visits, he moved in, and very recently he was adopted. It was a big tear fest. I know you guys can probably read, but the mother stood up and said that she and her husband had their own children, biological children, and then they got married, and they really wanted to have a child together, they weren't able to do that, and they found out after the fact, after they already had Connor in their home and then leading up to adoption, he was actually placed in their home for exactly 9 months to the day from being placed to adoption. So that really got everybody in the courtroom.
Take on a parent role in his family with younger kids. Parents were not always on board with taking care of the children. We actually found resources for all seven of the siblings. There were two aunts and a grandmother who agreed to take the kids. The king being 17 and a student in Missouri is allowed to choose whether or not he would like to be adopted or go into independent living. The grandmother was working on being licensed to take the king, and he chose independent living. The case manager agreed and the judge allowed it. in his mugshot.
Go ahead and pull that mic out.
Sorry. This is Hakeem in his mugshot from January, where he was involved in a robbery at the She's a Pistol gun store in Kansas. He was the lookout. He was not inside the building. However, he is going to be spending the rest of his life in jail because independent living was the best option for him, or so he said. His grandmother never got a chance to have him in her home and to give him what he needed to help him not end up like this. So I just want to let you know that we work very, very hard, because if we don't, this can happen to so many more of our kids. Sorry, go ahead. So we have a video also, but it's going to be too long, so I'll just tell you quickly about Demaje, who was my very first case in the very beginning. Demaje had been in care since he was 3 years old. His mom dropped him off at Spofford at three, said we're done. He had a lot of behaviors, very good with the bat. Cute kid. But he was in Spofford for 10 years. And in and out, different facilities. Randomly, our investigator, we had one family member named Mel's mom. He found her birth certificate, found her dad's name, who had passed away in Los Angeles years and years ago. He ended up calling the funeral home where he was buried, got a copy of the sign-in sheet from the funeral, found relatives' names on that, and managed to find Uncle Buzz, who is his mom's brother. And Uncle Buzz flew into Kansas City several times to meet criteria, was licensed, got licensed through Los Angeles, came here so many times just to get approval, flew Demaje back with him. After about 9 months, they did the adoption over the phone, and Demaje is now 16 or 17. He's been doing great. So that whole we don't stop at all, we will call the funeral homes. We will find the neighbor with the blue door that's around 50th Street. We will do anything, because if we don't, things could be worse.
That's just one of the programs that we do at FosterAdopt Connect. We don't try to do what other people do and do well. We look for things that are going to make a difference in terms of helping kids who've been abused or neglected have decent lives. And then we either create programs or we find them somewhere and bring them here. We innovate and we don't stop, because we believe that every child is valuable and every child deserves to have a positive life. So thank you very much. We appreciate you taking the time. Yeah.
I guess we're going to move right into Q&A, so we have time for probably two questions.
Does Kansas City or the state of Missouri or Kansas, any of them help you? I know that you were out by yourself a year.
We do have contracts for services that we provide. Extreme Recruitment, for example, was initially funded through grants from the Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, and then it was so successful that the state of Missouri included it into their budget. So about 50% of our revenue is state funding, and we do receive some of that from Missouri and some from Kansas. Yeah.
Do you all interface with CASA at all?
Absolutely. We interface with CASA in Kansas City. Martha Gershon is one of our biggest fans, and we're one of hers, and also in Johnson and Wyandotte counties as well.
CASA is amazing.
CASA is an amazing, amazing program.
Well, please stay up here. We have a special recognition for you for speaking at one of the largest and the greatest Rotary club in our network of over, I think, 34,000 clubs. So we're club number 13, so that's how old you are. So Lori, thank you. Liz and Jennifer, thank you for your great presentation.